Thank you so much for joining us this evening. My name is Matthew Compton, and I have the absolute honor of being the director of Bells of the Cascades ensemble you see before you. Thank you so much for coming out for our From Sea to Skye concert. This theme features a wide range of music related to water and traveling and Skye, as in from Scotland, which you'll hear later. The first piece you heard was A Town with an Ocean View, which came from the Studio Ghibli film Kiki's Delivery Service, which is just a purely delightful film. There's little conflict other than, as the movie goes along, Kiki, who is a little girl, she is a young witch who delivers bread for people. And so as she's flying around this new town that she moved to, she gets this job delivering bread, but then as the movie goes along, she starts to lose her magic. And so she gets into a lot of conflict with herself, and she starts to feel alone. And it really ends up more or less being an allegory for self-confidence, because as the movie continues towards the end, gradually she gets her confidence and her magic back and is able to continue delivering bread. But Joe Hisaishi, the composer of most Studio Ghibli films, just writes extremely memorable, delightful, but challenging works. And so last year we did the theme from My Neighbor Totoro. This year we did A Town from an Ocean View. And so good luck to whatever we do next year. But his music is just, it's delightful, it's catchy, it's fun, and just a great way to start the concert. The next piece you're going to hear is Judy Phillips' Roundelay, which comes from a larger three-movement work. And it just comes from the word round, like you're singing around, row, row, row your boat, and others like that. And so throughout the piece, you'll hear moments where one section of the table starts the melody, and then another picks it up from there. And gradually, it just kind of keeps circling around. But the reason that this piece fits this theme is Judy Phillips actually got part of her master's degree from Concordia University, Wisconsin, which is where I went to get my undergrad. And so Concordia, Wisconsin is right on Lake Michigan, so there's a staircase down to it. So kind of small world connections to it, but it's a delightful piece. And so I hope you enjoy Roundelay.
Thank you.
And now we'll breathe. One of the absolute greats in handbell literature is Karen Lakey Buckwalter. A lot of the time, whatever she writes is just pure gold. And Nocturne in A minor is one of those pieces that has become a staple and a standard in handbell literature, and for very good reason. It's methodical in its writing, it's stunning, and it really takes you on quite a journey through night. A nocturne is just a night piece, is what it translates to. And so it has a dark sense of emotion to it, and this piece has really just captivated many, many groups ever since it was released, I think, in the 90s. And so it has just become a wonderful collection to many, many groups' repertoires. And for the first time, ours, the group hasn't done it. But I wanted to, as I was planning how certain pieces might fit into the theme, this piece stuck out to me as I was looking through some various poetry, and Robert Frost's Acquainted with the Night stood out to me. And so I wanted to read to you that poem, as I think it ties nicely into this piece. I have been one acquainted with the night. I have walked out in rain and back in rain. I have outwalked the farthest city light. I have looked down the saddest city lane. I have passed by the watchman on his beat and dropped my eyes, unwilling to explain. I have stood still and stopped the sound of feet when far away an interrupted cry came over houses from another street. But not to call me back or say goodbye, and further still, at an unearthly height, one luminary clock against the sky proclaimed the time was neither wrong nor right. I have been one acquainted with the night.
Thank you.
There are some pieces that work for church, and then there are some that don't. And Frolic Flight of the Hummingbird is not one that you'll probably hear in a church setting. But this piece is just purely delightful. Kurt Meyer is a relatively recently published handbell composer, and his writing is just delightful. It's cinematic in nature. It takes you in unexpected ways. He's a doctor in Chicago, so on his spare time, he writes handbell music, which pays the bills, of course. So this piece, I think, really takes you on an incredible musical journey, and it almost sounds like a Disney piece. It sounds like it should belong in a Disney movie. It starts with this sort of majestic opening, and then it just takes off in a playful but fun, light-hearted spirit, and it really does represent the hummingbird so well. You'll get moments of if you blink, you'll miss it, where the melody just flies along, but you'll get moments of just perching and feeding, and then moments of just little flutters of the wings, and so it's just a really fun piece, and so I hope you just enjoy Frolic Flight of the Hummingbird.
Thank you.
In handbell music, one of the beauties of the instrument being a relatively young instrument is that most of our composers and arrangers are still alive. And so it's been great to be able to build connections with so many really excellent composers and conductors. Most of the pieces on this rep are people that I've met and had wonderful connections with. But one in particular is Brenda Austin, the composer of this next piece. She is the director of the Detroit Handbell Ensemble in Detroit, and she is just one of the most excellent musicians we have for handbells. She's a great composer, one of the absolute best conductors you will ever get to work with, and she's just a wonderful human being. And that's one of the things that brings me so much joy, is to get to know people who are like that. So as I was programming this theme, I asked Brenda, I said, hey, would you be willing to write us something? And she said, sure. So this next piece, Landscapes, was composed specifically for this concert series. And so it's a brand new world premiere in this concert cycle, but it takes you on a journey through so many different landscapes. You'll hear a desert, you will hear an ocean, you'll hear mountains, prairies, badlands, and a cityscape. And so it was really cool to see her thought process through it. The piece is what's called through composed, so there's always a new idea coming. Nothing returns, and so each piece, each section of the piece has a different identity to it, with a few tying ideas into it. But one of the other things, besides people who are excellent musicians, is we have a lot of really wonderfully talented people in many different ways, and Artie felt that this piece wouldn't really be complete without giving you all some sort of visual aid to really know what section you are hearing. And so he put together an absolutely gorgeous slideshow that'll focus on each different landscape. And so here's Landscapes.
Thank you.
Also, thank you to Naomi for operating the slideshow on that. We already had a score with specific points when to change it, so it has to be able to read music and everything. So, Naomi, thank you. Excellent job. The next piece we're going to play is an original composition of mine called Voyages, which I composed for St. Olaf Handbell Choir, and they're in Minnesota. Ben and Naomi and Garrett, who you will hear momentarily, all went to St. Olaf. Jill Marr, the director of the Handbell program there, is an incredible leader. She leads such a strong, historic Handbell ensemble, and many composers look at what they do and go, hey, can I write for you? It's one thing to have as a composer, it's one thing to have a commission come in, but it's another thing for someone to be like, hey, I want to write for you. And this ensemble, they just have such a long-standing tradition of musical excellence that it makes it so easy to want to create music for them. And so I asked Jill, I was like, I want to write something for you. What would you like? And she goes, I don't know, something. Great. That's a good place to start as a composer, because to me, that means free reign, do whatever you want. But she came back a couple days later. She goes, you know, what if we did something based on water? The students at St. Olaf are very environmentally conscious and focused, and to her, she had a spiritual connection to water. And so I was like, okay, great. So I wanted to avoid writing the flowy water piece, because usually that's what ends up happening. So I wound up getting stuck on the idea of sailing. And then when I got an idea of sailing, I could only think of like 17th, 18th century sailing vessels. So that is what I ran with, was that. So this piece, I put myself in the mindset of a young sailor going on the first ever voyage. So the morning of the voyage, it's foggy over the pier. And then as the day starts and the sun starts to rise, the excitement builds. And so you'll hear the energy building as people are loading things onto the ship. And then eventually the ship sets sail, and off we go, and you'll hear this rolling waves, the swing melody imitating that. And then, of course, you can't have a perfect voyage all the time, so you hear a stormy sea and crashing waves until eventually the sun breaks through the clouds, and you finally get a moment of peace as you near the end of the voyage. And then as the ship goes into the dock, you hear the captain and the crew singing the sea shanty, leave her, Johnny, leave her, the her being the ship. And so I hope you enjoy Voyages. One of my favorite things to do in music is collaborate with other musicians. Music has such a cool ability to be so versatile in what it does. And that is an example of that, being able to have Garrett, who we miss very dearly on Behind the Ringing Table, but hopefully we'll get him back soon. But one of the collaborations that I think the group has very strongly in our brains is when we went to Phoenix, Arizona, to do the closing concert of the Handel Musicians of America National Seminar, where we collaborated with one of my absolute best friends, Alex Giebert, and his Cathedral Bells of St. John's in Orange. We were invited to play this closing concert, and a lot of times when groups collaborate, they'll do three or four of the pieces together, and then one group plays, the other plays, and the collaboration is kind of a bouncing back and forth. Well, we decided to do the whole concert together, so we rehearsed here, they rehearsed there, and then we met together on a Wednesday and performed on Saturday. But this was one of the coolest collaborations we had ever had the chance to do. And Voyages, the piece you just heard, and Caelitus, Mihi, Vires, the piece you're about to hear, were two of those pieces that we did together. This is also kind of the point to which to say, come to our spring concerts next year, because Cathedral Bells is coming up here, and we're going to collaborate again next year. So, something to look forward to. This next piece, Caelitus Mihi Vires, has become sort of a BOC staple. It was the first piece that the group learned with me back in 2017, and we've done it every few years since. The title translates to My Strength is from Heaven, and Christian Humcke, the composer, he has only done two handbell pieces, but he has done a number of jazz, piano, organ, and other compositions, and he's an amazing musician. But this piece has so many different tonalities and characteristics that you don't generally hear in handbell literature. So I think this piece, it allows you to be taken to an almost otherworldly place. And so I invite you to sit back as we play Caelitus Mihi Vires.
Thank you.
That's one of those pieces that I will just never get sick of. It's just so exciting and energetic. So you'll probably hear it again down the line. The next piece you're going to hear basically inspired the title of this theme, From Sea to Sky, and that is the Scottish folk song, The Skyboat Song. This is it's an older tune, but it has been recently used in as the theme song for the show Outlander, if you have seen that show. I have not, so I have no context to give you for that show. But that's where it's from. That's what it's been used for recently, if you have any interest in seeing that. Find it somewhere. The Skyboat Song tells a story of the rescue of Bonnie Prince Charles. And so it goes through the idea of loss and trying to find the peace that was once his. And I think we can all relate to that in many ways, where we try to find ways to come back to some sort of center and to be found. I think if there's something that anything, we want to feel like we belong somewhere. And so I think this piece really exemplifies that. A little context to this arrangement in particular. My dad and I like to share various media that we like, and my dad has seen the show, and so he sent me the theme song from it, and he goes, "Hey, I really like this." I go, "Great." Put in my back pocket. And so for Christmas this last year, I arranged this arrangement for him. And so this weekend is our premiere of it. Not this weekend, but this concert cycle is the premiere of it. And there's not a lot of Handel rep that is written for bells and vocal solo, or in this case, vocal duet. So I wanted to have the words actually with the piece. And so we are delighted to be joined by Naomi and Garrett for the Skyboat song.
Soul, he said. soul, where is that glory now? Sing me a song of a light that is on, sacred that lad be I. Mary of soul, sun that shone. Give me the eyes, give me the soul, give me the land that's
Handbells are one of the most versatile instruments, I think, that we have. We can do just about anything on handbells, and I think the wide variety of literature that has come out in the last, especially decade, but even 15, 20 years, has just expanded what the instrument has been able to do. And one of those is to take music that you might not have ever heard of. This next piece, Jovano, Jovanke, is one of those pieces that I had never heard of until I found it on Mike Joy's arrangement on bells. And I'm going to read to you about the piece one second. Mike Joy, the arranger of this, he was shown this by a man named Dave Barry, and he was fascinated by mostly the scale of this Macedonian folk song, and I won't get into the music theory because you don't need to know it, but he was fascinated by how this sounded, and so I'll read to you the English translation of the text of this folk tune. Jovano, Jovanke, you sit by the Vardar, bleaching your white linen, my dear, looking at the hills. Jovano, Jovanke, I'm waiting for you to come to my home, and you don't come, my dear, my heart, Jovano. Jovano, Jovanke, your mother won't let you go, come to me, my dear, my heart, Jovano. Jovano is the Slavic form of Joan, and so the context to this is basically it is two people who love each other, but their parents do not approve of the relationship, and so it's that idea of forbidden love, and so I kind of lovingly refer to this as the Macedonian version of Romeo and Juliet without the death. So I hope you enjoy Jovano, Jovanke. It's just fun. It's good to just have fun sometimes. This second to last piece is Fisherman's Horizon, and it actually comes from the video game Final Fantasy VIII. And to give you a little bit of context to where this is in the game, when you arrive here, it is basically an idyllic, perfect world. You arrive somewhere where these people are living in just peace, which is just something that we all wish we could have. But this peace just kind of lulls you into a sense of just calm. And I think Alex Gebert's arrangement of this exemplifies that very well. It's a unifying piece that allows the musicians to just be connected to each other. And so it's just peaceful and enjoyable. So I invite you to just consider what your perfect day is as you listen to Fisherman's Horizon. I love that piece very much.
Hello. So I'm going to move this back so we're going to move the table. You remember when I said we had a surprise for you back a couple months ago? Yeah, this is it. So back in July of 2021 at National Seminar, I approached Alex Giebert, one of Matthew's best friends, if we would be willing to write a piece for Bells of the Cascades and Salmon Creek, which is where we are now. So that's what we're going to do. So before I do that, the piece is called Inspiring Presence. So I asked all of the ringers to send me a little blurb or like a sentence of why Matthew is inspiring to them. So I'm going to read a couple of them now. In the way that Matthew is inspiring in the way that he challenges and simultaneously encourages and supports people to be their best. He's a wonderful teacher, and the light of Christ shines through him. From Janice. He makes me a better musician. Excellent at giving feedback. Friendly and non-judgmental in nature. Always happy. Makes rehearsals fun and productive. He's patient, kind, encouraging. He's a confidence builder. Most inspiring talent person I know. I love working with him, and I'm so glad we get to do this for him. Debbie says she's honored to know Matthew and to be in one of his choirs. His age, coupled with the talent, composing and directing, experience, history, and promise of a great future is amazing. He affirms our values both as musician and as people. Kind encouragement, confident handbell playing. His amazing musical ability is an inspiration. It's a privilege to be able to make music with him. He's patient and encouraging to truly bring out the best in his ensembles. Matthew inspired me to be the best version of myself, to stretch my musical ability and to listen to music with my heart. Matthew's love and respect for the music translates seamlessly to love and respect for the musicians. It is truly a privilege to ring with him. Matthew has one of the biggest hearts, teaching me every day to love the world around me. Matthew inspires me and others to play pieces that are more difficult, and even though we want to give up, he calmly encourages us to keep at it. Matthew inspires me to learn and master new handbell techniques, such as 4 and 6 and 10, that even her mom, a ringer for many years, struggles with. Barb says, were it not for Matthew, I'm quite sure I wouldn't be ringing handbells today. Buddhists say, when the student is ready, the teacher will appear. My teacher appeared to me at the most perfect time in the most serendipitous way. Matthew, you have inspired and blessed my life for 6 years now with music, joy, and challenges. I will be forever grateful for your ability to encourage the best in me. Matthew inspires joy, passion, and dedication to the craft of bell ringing. He cultivates an attitude of deep love and respect for the instrument, the music, and the musicians, and that attitude is infectious. Let's see. Yeah, okay. I'm always amazed by the music that Matthew writes and how he takes the notes on the paper and brings them to life. He then encourages to inspire us to work harder than we've worked in our lives to bring out the best in the music and the instrument. It's always a joy to feel everything come together and feel so right. Three more, and these ones are more personal, and I think more relate with the rest of the group. Nancy says, Matthew inspires me to love handbells more than I already do. He provides never-ending encouragement and love, bringing out the best in those who work with him. As an individual and a choir, the inspiration is evident by our music making beyond anything I imagine would be possible when ringing handbells. This next one for the Dutch bros. People over here, there's a couple of them over here. Matthew has been an inspiration to me because he genuinely wants to know, how are you today? He cares about our hearts. He told this story to Andrea. He told the story of asking his Dutch bros barista every visit, how are you? And the barista responds, oh, you know, living the dream. And Matthew asks, are you really every day living the dream? He's curious and caring and wants to know for real. He has inspired me that when I ask people how they are doing, I'm asking because I genuinely care and want to know. I can relate to this. He's asked me one time in the car, I think it was on Wednesday, like three times, how are you doing? And then this last one comes from Martha. She says, a great master inspires us to be our best, in part by modeling excellence in the field, but more importantly by making us fall in love with them so much that we want to please them. Matthew is an excellent conductor who knows how to bring the best out of each ringer and the most out of each piece of music through his interpretation. But that doesn't happen in a void or just because he's skilled. It happens because he brings love into the rehearsal space. I know Matthew cares about me more as a person than as a bell ringer. When someone gives you love, you want to give it back. I honestly believe Matthew gets such wonderful music out of his groups because they are motivated by his love to give back their best to him and then resultantly to the audience. Yes, Matthew is an exceptional musician, but it's his character, more specifically his ability to love widely and genuinely. That brings out the best in others. He inspires me to play my best for him, but more importantly, to be kind and loving. So, this next piece, I'm going to invite Garrett to come up and direct. Oh, yes. Oh, a duplicate. Which ones are you missing? You should have all of them.
Wait, are they right here?
There. We have all the bells. There were a lot of bumps in the road because Matthew wanted to use the Salmon Creek tables. I wasn't aware of that. We also had a bell handle snap on Thursday, and I had to try and frantically get another bell for the other group. We also have a framed piece of the music that at the end of the concert, all of the ringers are going to sign for Matthew. So before you leave, make sure you sign the copy. So I'm going to invite Garrett up to conduct the piece. Yeah. Please give a round of applause. So this next piece is called Inspiring Presence and will be played by both groups you see in front of you for Matthew Compton from Exaltation Ringers and Bells of the Cascades, given in love and appreciation of Matt's loving leadership.
Can we add this was the first time we played together? Please, little grace.
Matthew is a remarkable man with nothing but love and joy in his heart. As you can see from the groups behind us, or behind me, that we exemplify that even so. So this is a gift for you.
Thank you.
Music's cool. Wow. I have the best job in the world. I get to work with people who mean so very much to me. I'm incredibly touched by... Yeah. I'm incredibly touched. Thank you so very much, BOC, Exaltation Ringers, Garrett, Alex, and anyone else who might have known. You can leave it there, it's fine. anyone else who might have known. It's truly an honor to have a piece commissioned for me, so thank you. And what a wonderful performance. God, I work with such good people. Every week I get to come to rehearsals with Exaltation Ringers, BOC, the church choir, the praise team, all these different people who are involved in so many different things and just make my life so much better. I am honored to direct excellent people, excellent musicians, and to share in a community of love. And so thank you. Anything else? I'm going shopping. Does anyone need anything? Just thank you so much. I love you all very, very much. And that's going to take me a second to recompose myself.
Surprise? Yeah!
You don't expect things like that, so thank you. Thank you. We're going to play one other piece, I guess, at this point. Nexus is a piece that I was commissioned to write in honor of Kevin McChesney's retirement. He directed Pikes Peak Ringers in Colorado Springs, which I now have the honor of also being the director of that group, and so I fly out there for things. But a Nexus is a connecting point between two or more things. And honestly, I cannot think of anything, maybe besides love, that connects people better than music. And I think, honestly, that was the best example I could have given to that, where two groups who, as we just heard, have never even rehearsed the piece together, played
once.
Something together.
You did it once.
Only rehearsed it once together. But still, either way, my point being, music unites people in such an incredible way, and I think it touches people in so many different ways, and I have had the absolute pleasure to have that connection with every single person up here that rang here, has been ringing here, and so it's so cool. I want to extend a personal thank you to Salmon Creek for hosting this church. We love... I mean, this concert, hosting the Salmon Creek first. Anyway, we love playing here, and it's a joy to come here. Thank you all so much for taking time out of your evening to come be a part of this concert experience. We love playing for people and creating these moments that you can hopefully go home with a smile on your face. After we're done with the concert this evening, if you would like to come up and talk to anyone, please do ask about the instrument, whatever it might be. But thank you so much for everyone. Glenn, thank you so much for operating the media. Naomi, for helping with slides. Thank you to those who helped with tickets and programs, Claire, or Darcy, Phyllis, Janice, and Teddy, and others who might have helped with this. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Music is such a cool uniting thing, and so I hope you enjoy our finale, Nexus. Yes, I did this last time. One more very big thank you. We are dearly missing Beth Davidson, one of our dear ringers. Her mother, unfortunately, just passed away like a week and a half ago. And so she went out to Minnesota earlier. And so for our first weekend, we had Robin Etheridge, who came down from Seattle to sub with us. And we are just absolutely so grateful to Andrew Scher, who flew up from California, rehearsed with us today, and is playing the concert. We have no lack of excellent musicians, and Andrew, who's another dear friend of mine, was willing to take some time out of his life to come up here. So thank you. Thank you. Josh, is there anything else I'm missing? Because at this point, I'm really not sure what to say. Nexus. Thank you so much. We will see you next time.